Hi everyone, and welcome back to The Journey. As you can see, today we're going to be talking about Guillain Barre syndrome, also known as GBS. So with that said, let's go ahead and get started. So Guillain Barre syndrome is also known as an autoimmune disease that affects the peripheral nerve system, okay? It is an acute, rapid segmental meaning that it happens in segments, okay, in various areas, and it happens along the peripheral nerves and the cranial nerves, okay? Also with that, you're going to have a producing of ascending weakness, meaning that it starts from the bottom and works its way up to the top. And what you're going to exhibit is dyskinesia, which is the inability to have voluntary movements. You're also going to have paresthesia, which is your numbness. And you're also going to see hyporeflexia, which is pretty much a diminish in your reflexes, okay? So patients who are going to have GBS, these are some of the symptoms that can occur due to the fact that it's affecting the peripheral nerves, okay? It is more frequent that it happens within males between the ages of 16 and 25, and again at 45 and 60, okay? So you will see this more within the males than the females. Also, 60 to 70% of the patients do recover completely. 5% do pass away because of this illness, and then the remaining do suffer some type of defect or disability because of this disease, okay? Also, one of the good things with this is the peripheral nervous system has Schwann cells within them. Those are the ones that are spared when the demyelination is occurring, and it allows for remyelination of the peripheral nerves, and this is what contributes to the recovery stage of disease, which is why you see 60 to 70% do get to recover completely, just because you do have the Schwann cells that are able to rejuvenate and try to help remyelinate and cover those areas, okay? Now, before I get to the causes, you may say, what is the demyelination and remyelination, right? Well, first you have to know what myelination is, okay? And I'm going to just draw a little thing here, all right? So let's say this is my cell, right? Everybody know you have the dendrites, okay? And then here is your axons, right? And then you have another cell here with its dendrites. This is the cell body with its axons. All right, and repeats the same process over and over and over. That's how your body gets you to do a certain function, right? When you say, hey, my brain is telling me move my hands, right? I have to send those signals, the dendrites receive them, the cell body analyzes the information, and then the axon carries out that instruction, okay? And it continues to go down until we get to the part of the body that is able to respond and do what it has to do. And that happens within nanoseconds, okay? So if you want more detail, I do have other neural videos as far as stroke and seizures and things like that, where I do kind of take my time and I explain. So if you guys want to get like a little brush up on myelination and things like that, you can also check out those videos. But to move this along, what happens is, I'm going to put that in a different color. What happens is, okay, along the way, you have these myelin sheets. Okay? And what those myelin sheet does, it works as an insulation. So the same way how you take a plug and you plug it into the outlet, right? You never take the actual wires itself and plug that in, right? Because the electricity has the ability to lose its strength because it can go different ways, right? So you want to insulate it, which is why you have that rubber casting around it, okay? And when you plug it in, now I know that the electricity or the energy is not going to be wasted going different places, but it'll go directly to where I need it to go. So the same way how you wrap cords, right, and helps to get better insulation, same thing what the body does, okay? These are like electricity, neurotransmitters are going through these areas here, and you want them to be properly insulated, okay? So that way the action is able to go directly to the source and is able to do its function, okay? with this disease, with the myelination, is all of a sudden, because of the autoimmune, right, it messes with the insulation. These are the myelins. So it demyelinates. Okay? But thank God for the Schwann cells that are spared. Over time, it's able to recover. Okay? But it's a very, very slow process. Okay? So that's what I mean when I say demyelination, remyelination, and what myelination pretty much is in a nutshell. It's insulation. Okay? So with this disease, GBS, it has its own uniqueness because I'm gonna go over MS and you're gonna see ALS, and you may say these things are very, very similar. How can I set each one apart? Well, this one has its own uniqueness in the fact that it starts from the bottom to the top, right? So if it ascends, okay, it can happen very rapidly. It can take time. It all depends on how progressive this disease is, okay? So if you guys remember that song from Drake, started from the bottom, now we're here, right? Started from the bottom, now we're here. So if that helps, just remember, it's going to start from the bottom. It tends to start from the bottom and works its way up to the top. It can get to the respiratory area, but remember, it starts from the limbs first. Well, that's why you have your peripheral nerves, right? But it can affect the cranial nerves at times, okay? So now we're going to get to the causes. So the causes is going to be unknown. No one really knows exactly what causes it, but it is related to your viral infection, such as your cytomegalovirus, okay, you have Epstein-Barr, mycoplasma pneumonia, H2N2, and you also have HIV. Those are your main common ones. It's not excluding, but those are your main common ones that you see with the person who's going to have GBS, had some type of viral infection. Also, because you have that viral infection, you have your body creates the inflammatory response, which then leads to demyelination of the dorsal roots of the neurons, right? And you may say, why is that happening? Why is the demyelination happening? Well, it is said that the infection organism mimics, right, the protein of the myelin, peripheral nerve myelin protein, right, that is within the body. So the body gets confused and doesn't know which one is the enemy and which one is the good guy. So sometimes in the sense of attacking, it attacks the good one versus the bad one, okay? And that's where you have the demyelination that occurs. Now we have the clinical manifestation, which is also known as our signs and symptoms, which is also known as our nursing assessment, okay? So what you're going to see with a patient who has GBS, you're going to have muscle weakness, okay? You're going to have ataxia, diminished reflexes of the lower extremities, hyperreflexia, which we talked about, the decrease in reflexes, okay, and weakness as well, all right? This can ultimately lead to tetraplegic, and tetraplegic is just another word for quadriplegic, okay? Neuromuscular respiratory failure, which I said, remember, we're starting from the bottom, now we're here, okay? So it can get to the point where it gets to the respiratory area, okay? And when it does, it's because the nerves have now gotten to the diaphragm and the intercostal muscles along this area that helps with breathing, okay? Also, you have paresthesia of the hands and feet, which is the numbness, okay, which can eventually lead to paralysis, okay, where you can be paralyzed. Also, you may exhibit pain, right? Pain in those limbs, and you don't know why, okay? You've taken things and it's not working, okay? Also, this is the top portion is mainly with the peripherals. Now the bottom portion is with the cranial nerves, because like I said before, it can affect the cranial nerves. So in the case that it does, you can exhibit blindness if it's attacking the optic nerve, okay? Bulbar muscle weakness, and with bulbar muscle weakness, you'll hear me say a lot when I get to myasthenia gravis, but that's pretty much weakness within the face area and within the eyes. You have the drooping of the eyes, and you're not able to swallow certain things, right? So that's what they mean when they say bulbar weakness, okay? Now with that takes up glossopharyngeal and the vagus nerve, all right? Next, you have the inability to swallow, talk, and chew, and again, that's because of your glossopharyngeal nerve. Another, you have instability of your cardiac system, right? And the reason for that is because you're going to have fluctuation of your blood pressure. One minute it's up, one minute it's down. Bradycardia, tachycardia, okay? So your
your system is going to be very liable, right? Where you don't really know if it's going to stay this way, if it's going to come down, and how much it's going to come down. And that's because of the vagus nerve, okay? Also, put it big and bold, all right, so you guys can kind of start seeing the difference between these different diseases, okay? This one does not affect LOC, okay? LOC just pretty much means level of consciousness, all right? Anything dealing with cognition, right? Within my brain, my function of how I think, how I rationalize, is not affecting that, all right? Whereas in multiple sclerosis, it is, all right? So just kind of point those things out. GBS doesn't, ALS doesn't, multiple sclerosis, yes, okay? So cognition is not affected, and again, functional recovery may take up to 2 years. Like I said, even though your body is still able to rejuvenate and be able to repair itself, it's going to take a long process. So with any time within 2 years, okay, and anything that you see after the 2 years that is not improving, okay, that is because it is going to be permanent, a permanent deficit or disability, and it's because of axonal damage, okay? So the axons itself has gotten damaged, not just the myelin sheath insulation that supports. Now we have the diagnostic testing to see if a person has GBS. So what you're going to do is you're going to have a respiratory function test. That's one of the things that can be done. And changes in the vital capacity and a negative inspiratory force kind of indicates that, hey, something is going on with your respiratory status. It's not the only thing, because again, you have ALS that can cause that, you have multiple sclerosis that can cause that, so you want to narrow it down. So that's just one of the things that they can do. The next thing that they can do is a serum lab test, not the one that that checks your chem 7 or chem 12 or your CBC, but one that checks for your cerebrospinal fluid, okay? Because with the cerebrospinal fluid, there's going to be an increase in protein level, and that's going to be detected within the CSF, okay? Which can show that maybe this is an indicator of GBS. Also, the clinical presentation. How is the patient being presented? What are they complaining of? Are they saying that, you know, before my toes were numb, now it's moving its way up to my knees, now I'm feeling it up to my thigh? You know, what are they saying? Are they saying, you know, the symptoms that I went over just previously? Okay, and then also if any history of any recent viral infection, because again, that is a link of what may cause this trigger of the autoimmune disorder to start occurring. Okay, also I have my medical management. Now with my medical management, okay, depending on how bad the respiratory system is or how it's functioning, if it is compromised, I am going to be put on a ventilator. The patient's going to be put on a ventilator, okay? Before we get to that point, if it can be managed with respiratory therapy, then we're going to go ahead and do that, which we're going to have our bureau treatments around the clock, you know, suctioning, coughing, you know, making sure that that airway kind of stays clear. Also, you have your anticoagulants. You have anticoagulants, which is like your Lovenox, your heparin. You have your SCDs, which are those sequential compression device machines that you have, or old-fashioned, the compression stockings itself, okay? And that is to prevent a thrombus, because again, the main thing for a thrombus, you don't want it to get dislodged and end up traveling to the heart or the lungs, okay? Because then now you have pulmonary edema, or you will have an MI, all right? Also, you have your plasmapheresis and your IVIG. Your IVIG is pretty much your IV immunoglobulin, okay? So that what that does, it helps to decrease antibodies that is within the bloodstream, okay, of the peripheral nerve myelin. And a plasmapheresis is just pretty much they're taking out your blood. In a nutshell, okay, I'll go more in depth when I go to my stand graphics, because this is one of the main things that they kind of use and help with those type of patients. But plasmapheresis just pretty much, they're taking away the blood to get rid of the antibodies, and they're replacing it back, okay, with new fresh blood, okay, mainly plasma, because plasmapheresis, so they're going to exchange, take out the plasma and give you more plasma. Okay, so this is still considered a blood transfusion that you will have, but they're taking away, so that way it decreases the amount of antibodies that you have that is attacking the body, so that way the body's not attacking itself.
okay? They prefer to use the IVIG more than the plasmapheresis just because it has less side effects, okay? Also, you're going to have your ECG monitoring or your EKG monitoring because, again, remember that vagus nerve, if it is altering the cranial nerve, right, you have that fluctuation of tachycardia, bradycardia, high blood pressure, low blood pressure, okay? So for that, you're going to give short-acting agents, okay, not long-acting. So short-acting agents is going to be used because when it's high, you want to give the medication, and it's going to wear off quickly because then if it goes low, then you want to give fluids or things like that, okay? So very short-acting because you just never know when it's going to fluctuate, okay? And like I said before, your fluids for your low blood pressure. Last but not least, our nursing interventions. Now, with our nurse intervention, as you can see, it's pretty much trying to manage or control or improve the signs and symptoms, okay? Because there is no cure. There's only a treatment that can help minimize the symptoms, okay? So you're going to manage respiratory function. Why? Because they may be respiratory failure. So you want to tell them, you know, deep breathing, coughing, sitting upright, you know, to get more air in, all right? Respiratory treatments, okay? Things of that nature. Enhancing physical mobility, all right? So the energy that they do have to move and do different things or whatever, you want to exercise that so that way you can kind of strengthen the muscle, all right? Before they become a quadriplegic or things like that, okay? You want them to be moving, all right? And it can be passive range of motion, they're still able to do it, okay? So that way they don't get contracted and things like that. Also, you want to provide nutrition, okay? So the patient is going to be on a ventilator. You know that you may have to use an NG tube or you may have to do an OG tube. Most of the time, people who are on ventilators, they use an OG tube. Okay, and you'll get feeding through that way. If they're not and they're able to eat, you want to make sure that you have a suction at hand in case they do aspirate or they choke or they may not be able to swallow everything and they need to bring stuff back up, right? Also, you want to keep the head of the bed, all right, head of the bed elevated, right? No one eats sitting down or slouched or anything like that. And for this person who does have difficulty with that, you want to make sure that their head is up, all right? At least 30 degrees, okay? Preferably 45, but at least 30. No lower than 30, right? Now, also you want to improve communication, all right? Also, decrease fear and anxiety, right? One minute you're out and you're moving and you're doing things and all of a sudden now you're not able to move. That's very frightening, especially if you're in the bed and you're trying to get out of the bed and you're like, what's going on, right? So you want to help to calm their nerves. They help deal with their fears and just explain to them exactly what's going on step by step and how we can strengthen it, you know, focus on their strengths and not their weaknesses, and let them know each and every day, you know, even if it's just a little improvement, you know, that can be the hope that brings them to tomorrow, all right? Also, monitoring and managing potential complications, okay? So again, your potential complications, your choking, your aspiration, your respiratory failure going bad, respiratory failure, period. And teaching strategies, you want to teach them different things, you know, like the things that I just mentioned, you know, ways where they can, if they have facial drooping, things like that, what are some ways that they can help with that, okay? Which, you know, you can take the eye, close one of the eyes. If you notice that you're not having control, you can use artificial tears. Again, I'll explain more so of that with my myasthenia gravis. You know, make sure that, you know, when they get in the physical activity that they're not exerting everything. You want them to conserve some of that energy. You know, if they live in a two-story house, you know, try to put the main things on the first floor so that way they're not going up, coming down, right? Because again, they do have weakness and they do suffer from some fatigue. So, you know, if everything is accessible to them in their reach, you know, you're strategizing, how can I beat this thing, okay? How can I still have a functional quality of life? And that is pretty much it with GBS. If you have any questions or comments, please remember to put that down in the comment section below. If you want to see more added information, please check out the description box.
Again, if you have not subscribed yet, what are you waiting for? Go ahead and click that subscribe button. Again, I also have an Instagram. You can follow me there to see all my latest videos and just more information. And again, thank you for coming on this journey. I'll see you on the next one. Bye.